Josh, Josh 5:1. Turn over to the last book, the last chapter of the book of Psalms. You got anything to praise God about this morning?
Amen.
Amen. Praise God, praise God. Look at the one beside you and say, boy, I got a lot to praise him for.
Hey, I got a lot to praise him for.
Amen. Amen. I think, I hope you come into the house of God looking for a blessing tonight. I hope you know that you've got a lot to praise him for. I hope you come in prepared to worship, prepared to praise. Amen. Prepared to seek the face of God, because that's what it's going to take. Amen. Oh, thank God, thank God. Because we've got so much to be thankful for. Amen. The Word of God tells us in 1 Peter 1:3, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, which according to his abundant mercy has begotten us again unto a lively hope by the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. I'm glad that we have got a lively hope this morning. I'm glad, amen, that we do have the promise of the resurrection. How? Only through and by Jesus Christ. Amen. Thank God that we do have a lively hope. We've got a lot to be excited about this morning. We've got a lot to praise him about this morning. We've got a lot to rejoice in. Him. Praise ye the Lord.
Yes.
Praise God in his sanctuary.
Yes.
Praise him in the firmament of his power. Yes. Praise him for his mighty acts. Yes. Praise him according to his excellent greatness. Yes. Praise him to the sound of the trumpet. Praise him to the psaltery in the harp. Praise him with the timbrel and dance. Praise him with the stringed instrument and organs. Praise him upon the loud cymbal. Yes. Praise him upon the high sounding cymbal. Let everything that hath breath praise the Lord. Dung it
And if it bear fruit, well, and if not, then after that thou shalt cut it down. And he was teaching in one of the synagogues on the Sabbath. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for the reading of your word today. We thank you, Father, oh God, for all everything you've already done here this morning, the things you're doing in people's hearts. I pray, God, that they'll listen unto what you've got to say for them. And God, I pray, Father, that you'll just move in a mighty way, Lord. Lord, if you ever let us understand more about your word, or there'll be one here that's not saved, that they'll get saved, there'll be one backslidden, they'll be reclaimed, God. Oh, those that are suffering, Father, that they'll get relief. And God, we just praise you and glorify you. Don't we know, God, that you can do all these things, and Jesus, wonderful, and holy name I pray, amen and amen. Oh, praise God, we see here, the way I love the way Jesus teaches, amen, the way he tells us in his word of God, we see that Jesus is actually, he's addressing what came through verses 1 through 5, amen, he's addressing a situation that was going on. We see how Pilate had killed some Galileans, which were Jewish people. He killed the Galileans and mingled their blood with sacrifice. And the people that were around, they were asking Jesus, were these people sinners above all the other Galileans? And Jesus told them, well, no, they weren't worse. A sinner's a sinner. Go ahead and say that. A sinner's a sinner. They weren't worse than the other Galileans, but except ye repent, ye shall likewise perish. It comes down to personal repentance. Then Jesus goes on, and the Bible goes on, and it gives us another example where the Tower of Siloam, amen, which was in Jerusalem, it fell, amen, and killed 18 people. Well, why did these 18 people have to die? Were they sinners above everyone else? No. Jesus said, nay, no. He said, except ye repent, ye shall also likewise perish. Right. Amen. We see that things are going to happen in people's lives. Right. That tower didn't fall on people because of their sin.
That's right.
Amen.
Amen.
Things don't happen in your life just because of your sin. Now they can. Right. But except ye repent, ye shall likewise also perish. You have to repent. It comes down to personal, individual repentance. Yeah. I can't repent for you. You can't repent for me. My sin is my sin. Your sin is your sin. And I'm the only one that can repent more. That's what Jesus is saying here. And then he teaches us in a parable. Oh, I love the way parables talk. It's something that happens in everyday life that we can relate to. If you can't relate to what Jesus is talking about in the Word of God, then you're not going to be able to apply it unto your life.
Amen.
Jesus knew that. He taught in parables, stories, everyday life happenings, and everyday life events. Amen. We learn from every day, don't we? You should. If you don't learn from the things that are going on in your life, something's wrong with you.
Amen.
Amen. We see how Jason, this morning in Sunday school, he used an example of me working on a car. Amen. He said, I can lay hands on that car and pray all day. God can fix it now. I've seen it happen. But we have to do our part.
Amen.
We have to do what God has required us to do. Amen. I had to do four attempts. I fixed four different things on the car trying to fix one problem. But I prayed a lot.
Amen.
I did my part.
Amen.
And in God, he led me to the problem. Amen.
Amen.
Praise God. And that's the way we have to do in our lives.
Amen.
You're going to have to work on one thing at a time. Don't try to fix it all at once.
Amen.
And you may have to make several attempts.
Amen.
But don't give up.
Amen.
Amen. Except ye repent. You have to repent. The problem in your life is the problem in your life. It may not even match up with the problem that's in my life. God knows I've got plenty.
Yes.
Amen. God knows I'm not perfect. Don't look at me as a perfect person. God knows I have to repent.
Right.
Amen. Amen. We all do.
Yes.
Amen. Oh, not just once a month.
No.
We repent every day. We need to go to the Lord every day. Amen. Oh, thank God we don't have to go to the Pope.
Amen.
I'm glad that my intercessor I know is Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Amen. I know that my intercessor is not a man.
Right.
Amen. My intercessor is the Lord.
Amen.
Amen. And he's seated at the right hand of the Father.
Amen.
I don't have to have some man in Rome intercede on my behalf. I've got one that's sitting on the throne.
Amen. Amen.
That's what it comes down to, amen. Oh, God, he doesn't want anyone to perish, amen. By this time here in our text, Jesus had been ministering for 3 years. Give or take, he had been ministering roughly for 3 years. That's why he's here using this parable of the barren fig tree. He had been ministering for 3 years, and he comes to Jerusalem, and he's looking out, and he doesn't see any fruit. He's talking about the religious leaders and the people of the day, amen. He's talking about how they're not bearing any fruit, how they're using the word of God to keep people down rather than to lift people up, how to push people under their thumb rather than to put them under the grace of God and the mercy of God. Amen. We still have a lot of Pharisees today. Amen. We have a lot of people who do that today, but God wants no one to perish. The word of God tells us so. The Lord, he's not slack concerning his promise, as some men count slackness, but as long suffering us, we're not willing that any should perish, but that who should come to repentance? That all should come to repentance. All, amen. He's being patient for your sake.
Yes,
amen.
Yes.
When's the Lord coming back? I don't know. I guarantee it's not because of this moon stuff that's going on. That ain't got nothing to do with it.
That's right.
I don't care what any preacher tells. They don't know the time. They don't know the hour. They don't know.
That's right.
Amen. It's not about all this moon stuff.
Right.
It's a God thing.
Yes.
When God says come back, he's going to come back.
Yes.
He's coming back to get his people. He's coming back to get the saved.
Yes.
Don't worry about the time. You better just be ready.
Yes.
Amen. Because if you knew in what hour the thief comes, you'd be ready, wouldn't you?
Yes.
Amen. We'd be ready. And that's the main thing. We have to be ready for the coming of the Lord. We're waiting patiently.
Yes.
You should be.
Yes.
Well, he ought to come back next week. Maybe he will. Yeah. A day with the Lord is 1,000 years, and 1,000 years is a day.
Yes.
We see time is irrelevant. That's the way that we keep up with it. Now we look around us and we see that the way the world is going, I can't see it being much longer. But praise God, it might be another 1,000 years. I don't know. It might be 10,000 years. God doesn't keep time.
Amen.
We do.
Amen.
He's long-suffering.
Amen.
He is waiting on people to get in.
Amen.
And he knows who's going to, and he knows who isn't. Amen.
Amen.
Oh, thank God. But we see in our text, amen, oh, that he teaches us, doesn't he? He teaches us through nature. I like this saying, George Washington Carver, amen. I love to think of nature as an unlimited broadcasting station through which God speaks to us every hour and we'll only tune in. So many people are not tuned in. See, God is using parables, natural nature events, to teach us things about him. But we just have to tune in.
Amen.
I love these parables. I love the way he shows us things. He teaches us, amen, through nature in order for us to see his nature, and that is the nature of grace, amen. Thank God that his nature is grace, and we would all go to heaven. Thank God that his nature, amen, he shows us his nature by showing us the parable of the fig tree for one. We see, amen, that this fig tree needed some work, didn't it? We see some things in this fig tree. We all end up in a disappointment. Who in here has ever been disappointed?
Amen.
Who in here has ever disappointed anybody?
Amen.
We can get in the disappointment valley many times, can't we? I've disappointed people in here. Amen. Go ahead, shake your head. It don't hurt my feelings. Amen. I've disappointed people in here. That's just the way it is. That's life. You've disappointed people in here. That's just the way it is. That's life. Oh my, but we can get stuck in Disappointment Valley if we're not careful, because we get so disappointed in this life. People don't live up to your expectations. You might as well figure that one out. People will never live up to your expectations out of them. Whether it's your husband, your wife, whoever it is, they'll never live up to what you expect. That's my wife. Amen. They won't live up to that. We let people down. Thank God that he won't ever let us down. Thank God that he is long-suffering. Thank God that he is being patient for our sake. Oh, wow. We see in this parable, we see several things. Amen.
You see, the owner that's dissatisfied, he's dissatisfied, amen. Then you see the manager of the vineyard, he's disappointed. He disappointed the owner. Then that tree is dysfunctional. You got 3 D's there. It looks like my report card did in school. You got 3 D's. You got somebody dissatisfied. You got a disappointed person. You got something that's dysfunctional. Amen. I guarantee we can. Every one of us in here can relate to one area of this parable, no matter where you're at in life.
Amen.
Amen. We can relate to that. I'm glad that God's word is relative in the life in which we live.
Yeah.
Amen. It's not old sayings and old wives' tales. It's relevant to today just like it was then.
Amen.
The word of God is what we live by. Amen. It's what we die by. It's what we're going to be judged by. Amen. Oh, we see that all of you have been dissatisfied. Amen. Oh, we see you've sown seed somewhere and it didn't produce anything. And you're dissatisfied with it. Amen. I'm talking about any type of seed. Amen. Oh, we see that. Oh, we have been disappointed many times because the people that we love and we witness to and the people that we care about, amen, and the standard that we expect out of others to live, they don't live up to it.
Amen.
And then, that's disappointing, isn't it?
That's right.
You expect your children to live up to this, 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 and this, and they don't, you're disappointed.
Amen.
Amen. Anybody's children ever disappointed other than mine?
Oh.
Amen. It happens, though. But yet we still love them, though.
Right.
We still love them, no matter how bad they disappointed, we still love them.
That's right.
Oh. No matter how dissatisfied we are, we still love them. God still loves you.
Amen.
We see, amen, that there's a whole lot of things that are dysfunctional in our lives. Amen. Each and every one of us in here, we have a lot of potential. Who in here has got potential?
Amen.
10 people. Who in here has got potential?
Amen.
Every one of us in here have got potential.
Amen.
Amen. But that potential has never developed, so you're dysfunctional.
Right. Amen.
Amen. You not let God have His perfect way in your life.
Right.
You let not listen to the Lord. You tried to do what you wanted to do and not what God wants you to do. And then you don't live up to your potential because you're outside of God's will.
Amen.
And that makes you dysfunctional. When you're not in God's will, you will be dysfunctional. There are no two ways around it, amen. This parable is disappointing. You read this parable, it's disappointing. Amen. Any way you look at it, it's disappointing. The manager, owner, he's disappointed because there wasn't no fruit. Remember now, we're talking about Jesus, we're talking about the Lord. Amen. He's looking over Israel, over Jerusalem. They've not brought any fruit for it. Amen. And then he sees the dysfunctional, the religious leaders at the time. Amen. We see that we know people, don't we? Amen. You're going to reap what you sow. Can you say that? You will reap what you sow. If you treat people bad, guess what? You're going to be treated bad. If you mess people over in relationships, guess what's going to happen? Boom! You're going to get messed up.
Amen.
You're going to reap exactly what you sow. You don't put out corn and get grapes out of it. Amen. You're going to reap what you sow. You're either sowing something good or you're sowing something bad. Amen. And you know, speaking of something bad, the Bible tells us that we're going to know people by their fruit. We're going to know false prophets by their fruit. We're going to know, amen. We're going to know people by the fruit that they bear. Matthew 7:16-20, ye shall know them by their fruits. The men gather grapes of thorns or figs of thistles. Even so, every good tree brings all. Boy, this makes so much good sense. A good tree is going to bring forth good fruit. A bad tree is going to bring forth bad fruit. Why doesn't they recognize, does it? But God, He's telling us,
Amen. He's telling us in his word. But a corrupt tree brings forth evil fruit. A good tree cannot bring forth evil fruit. Neither can a corrupt tree bring forth good fruit. Every tree that bringeth not forth good fruit is what? It's cut down, hewn down, and cast into the fire. Amen. If a tree does not bring forth fruit, it's going to be cut down and thrown into the fire. Are you bringing forth any fruit for the Lord? The Bible is very clear. We are supposed to be a fruitful people. But we got stuck in disappointment about it. We got stuck in a place where God doesn't want us to be. And we end up staying there. But you know, the only way out of this disappointment valley is with the Lord, with the Holy Ghost, with God leading you, with Jesus leading you. That's the only way to get out of there. Amen. Amen. We see how the Lord works. Amen. Because we get so much stuff in our life. Amen. You see that the tree didn't bring forth any fruit. The owner was disappointed. He come to get him a fig. Amen. Figs are little fruit. You don't dig a farm or anything. They grow on a little tree, on a fig tree. Amen. He come to get some fruit. After 3 years, it should have been bringing forth some fruit. Well, cut that thing down. Get rid of it. It's just taking up space. Well, a lot of times we have things in our life, don't we, that take up a lot of space. Yes. Amen. Can you say this? If it don't grow, it's got to go. That's what I'm trying to say there. If it don't grow, it's got to go. If it don't grow, it has got to go. We've got things in our lives that are just taking up space where something good could be planted.
Amen.
Amen. Something good could be planted there.
Yes.
Something good could be growing there.
Right.
Amen. We put things in our lives, amen, like hate and bitterness and anger and wrath and all sorts of calamity. We put adultery, backbiting, we put gossip. We put all kinds of things in our lives that take up the good ground.
Right.
Where things could grow.
Amen.
Things could grow there because we've got so many dead things that are taking up space, but God wants to fill them up with good things. Amen. He wants you to cut down the dead things. He wants you to get rid of them so that things that are meaning something to Him will begin to grow.
Amen.
Amen. Oh, my. We see, amen, and many of us, we have a hard time doing that, pastor included. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. We let dead things stay right in the way, don't we? Amen. Oh, but God tells us in Galatians 5:19, this is the New Living Translation, amen, when you follow the desires of your sinful nature, the results are very clear. Sexual immorality, impurity, lustful pleasures, idolatry, sorcery, hostility, quarreling, jealousy, outbursts of anger, selfless ambition, dissension, division, envying, drunkenness, wild parties, and other sins like these. You see all the things, amen, that are dead, all the sins of the flesh that will grow in your life if you let it. But let me tell you again, as I have before, that anyone living that sort of life will not inherit the kingdom of God. You're living in the fruit of the flesh. You're letting those dead things grow. Amen. You're not going to inherit the kingdom of God. But the Holy Spirit produces this kind of fruit in our lives. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. There is no law against these things. Amen. We see the fruit of the Spirit. We have to get rid of the dead things in our lives if you want the fruit of the Spirit to grow. Amen.
Amen.
How long has it been since you brought forth any fruit in your life? How long has it been? What is going on? How long do you think God is going to be long-suffering? How long is He going to put up with it? Another year. In this case, we see the manager of the vineyard, well, give me just one more year.
Amen.
God doesn't have to give you one more breath.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. How long is He going to put up with it? Oh, we see, amen, that Jesus here
Look at verse number 7 in our text. Then said he unto the dresser of his vineyard, behold, these 3 years I come seeking fruit on this tree and find none. Cut it down, why cumbereth it the ground? Amen. Oh my. Remember, Jesus speaking of Israel here. He'd been 3 years in preaching. It'd been 3 years, people have been spreading the gospel. The gospel had been growing, amen. But we see, amen, that there's still no fruit. There's very little fruit out of Israel. We see the religious leaders of the time, amen. We see that they weren't doing what Jesus would have them do. We know that Jesus ends up getting crucified for your and my sins, for the sins of the whole world, amen. We see that we have to, amen, get rid of the dead things. We see the parable of the fig tree. Amen. We see the owner is the Lord, of course. The vineyard represents the nation of Israel. The tree represents the leadership that was in Jesus' day. Remember what he's addressing. You've got to read verse 1 through 5. Then you can piece it all together, Christian. Amen. And the fig represents peace and prosperity. Anywhere in the Word of God, you see a fig, it always represents peace and prosperity. We see, amen, that Jesus is looking out over this. And he doesn't see what he should be seeing because, you know, he made a promise. God made a promise to a man named Abraham that he would multiply him, that he would be the father of many nations over in Genesis 17. Amen. We see that God made a promise. And he said, you'll be the father of many nations. You're going to multiply your children. You're going to be as the sands of the sea, the stars in the sky. That's a lot.
Amen.
Amen. And when God makes a promise, God keeps a promise.
Amen.
Amen. Thank God that he does. Amen. Oh, there's a whole lot of religious activity in the place that Jesus had around Jerusalem at the time. There's a lot of religious activity, but there wasn't any fruit being produced. Boy, does that not remind you a lot about our world in which we live today?
Amen.
There is a lot of religion. We see, oh, back to the old Pope again. Amen. We see, y'all don't mind if I talk about him, do you? He needs Jesus just like everyone else.
Amen.
There's only one way to get there.
Amen.
Amen. We see that the Pope, he's got millions and millions worldwide that'll come and listen to him speak in a language that they don't even understand.
Amen.
That follow him and think that he is interceding on their behalf. Call him the Holy Father. Their doctrine is so messed up they can't even, they had to write a book of their own to even make it make any sense. They don't go by the Bible, by the way. Oh, but we see, amen, that the Pope has got a huge following. Look at the religious leaders that are messed up in this country in which we live.
Amen.
Look at the leaders in this country that are messed up.
Amen.
Look at the leaders in your community that are messed up.
Amen.
Look at the leaders in your schools that are messed up. Look at the leaders in homes that are messed up.
Amen.
Amen. We see God is looking for good leaders. Amen.
Amen.
He's looking for leadership. He's looking for leadership in the home. He's looking for leadership in the nation. He's looking for leadership in the schools, in the counties. He's looking for leadership in our states. He's looking for leadership everywhere. Good leaders.
Amen.
Godly leaders. Amen. But we see so much rotten fruit. We're talking about parables. If you want to read a prophecy back in the book of Isaiah, the whole book of Isaiah, Isaiah chapter 5, amen. You read Isaiah chapter 5 and you'll see a parallel account to the fig tree. You will.
Amen.
Remember Jesus talking to people who knew the law. They knew the Old Testament. They knew the book of Isaiah.
Right.
Amen. So he made a reference back.
Amen.
Oh my. Jesus knew everything they were thinking.
Right.
He knows everything you're thinking. God knows everything you're thinking.
Right.
He does. He knows if you're putting out rotten fruit, if you're putting out good fruit.
Amen.
Amen. Well, why don't he just take you all in? He's going to give you a little while.
Amen.
He's going to give you a while. Thank God that he does.
Amen.
Amen. And you know, here we read in our parable, amen,
We read in a parable that the owner wanted to cut it down of the vineyard. He wanted to cut it down because it wasn't bringing forth any fruit. But the manager of the vineyard, just give me one more year. Give me one more year and I will dig around it. I'll loosen the ground up. Only God can loosen the ground up in the hardened heart.
Amen.
The Bible says that he can break up that fallow or that hard ground. He can break it up, but only God can. Only God can break up that hard ground. Give me one more year. I'll dig around it and then I'm going to dung it. Y'all know what dung is, don't you? I don't have to put that up on a PowerPoint. That doesn't always mean you're going to have happiness and rose petals fall into your life in order for you to grow. Sometimes there has to be some more dung come into your life so that you can grow. Because if you've ever noticed in your life when you were going through dung, you grew more then than any other time in your spiritual walk.
Amen.
So you have to dung it and dig around it, get the fertilizer into the roots, because if you're not trusting in God for it to grow, for you to grow, then you're not going to grow.
Amen.
Amen. But it might take a little more dung. You've got a year. This tree did. You may not have another minute.
Amen.
Well, I just don't understand why all this bad stuff happens to me. Know that God's got a plan and you're part of it.
Amen.
You're part of his plan. Well, why does God let bad things happen to good people? You ever figure out now? Let me know. Amen. I can go into a good theological explanation, but that's just a bunch of dumb. Amen. God's got a plan that I don't know anything about. Amen. That's why bad things happen to good people. Amen. I don't know, but God does. He's got a perfect way. My way's not perfect, but his is. Amen. We just have to stay hooked up. We've got to let the dresser dig around us. We've got to let him prune us. We've got to let him dung us and fertilize us with his word. Not only the junk that comes into your life, but his word, which is the best fertilizer you can possibly get. Amen. We've got to let him work on us. Amen. We have to. You see, I am the vine, ye are the branches. He that abideth in me and I in him, the same bringeth forth much fruit, for without me ye can do nothing.
Amen.
You can bring forth a lot of fruit if you stay in the vine.
Right.
Amen. Amen. We are the branches. Who in here is a branch? Everybody in here is saved. You're a branch. If you're not saved, you're not a branch because you're not in the vine.
Right.
You've got to get in the vine. Amen. Oh, but we see. Oh, the word of God goes on to say, here is my Father glorified that ye bear just a little bit of fruit. No, that ye bear much.
Amen.
Abundant is actually what that word translates from. Abundant.
Amen.
That you bear abundant fruit. Remember, Jesus came into this world what? So that we may have life and have it more abundantly.
Amen.
Remember who come and who else come? The thief's coming for, but to steal, kill, and destroy. I've come that you may have life and have it more abundantly.
Amen.
Have much more. You're to bear much fruit. So shall ye be my disciples. Amen. Ye shall be my disciples. Because he has chosen you. You're a chosen generation. Ye've not chosen me, but I've chosen you and ordained you that ye should go and bring forth fruit. See, God tells us to bring forth fruit.
Amen.
If you're dead today, you're not bringing forth any fruit. You need to bring more fruit.
Amen.
God tells us, that's a commandment, and that your first fruit should remain. That whatsoever you shall ask the Father in my name, he shall give it to you. These things I command you, that ye love one another. Amen. Praise God. We know as the word of God goes out, he says his word will not return void. Amen. It will accomplish what he sends it to do. Amen. It will prosper everywhere that it happens to go. So what are we to do? We're to throw the seed out.
Amen.
It's okay. You throw the seed of the Word of God out, and it's going to accomplish what God wants it to accomplish.
Amen.
It will. He says it will. Whatsoever you find, whatever so, and whatsoever you do, do it heartily as to the Lord. And not unto man, knowing that of the Lord ye shall receive the reward of the inheritance, for ye serve the Lord. You do it for God, amen. Whatever you do it heartily.
Amen.
If you're a witness for God, bring forth fruit.
Amen.
Every one of them here have been called to witness, go ye therefore into all the world.
Yes.
Amen. Each and every one is a great commission. We can go everywhere and spread the gospel unto every creature, baptizing in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. That's what we're to do.
Amen.
We're to bring forth fruit.
Amen.
How many of us are bringing forth any fruit? Or do we look more like a dead fig tree? Just cut it down, throw it in the fire, and plant a new one back. I'm going to give it one more year. Give it one more year. I'll dig around it. I'll dung it. I'll fertilize it. I'll do everything I can. I'll take special attention with this one tree. Now, I know you can look all through the text. Apparently, the rest of the fig trees were doing fine. Just this one. Y'all take time just for one.
Amen.
Thank you, Lord.
Amen.
Just this one. Y'all took time just for one.
Amen.
I wasn't producing. I was an evil tree. I was producing evil fruit. But he took time just for this one.
Amen.
He gave me a whole lot longer than a year. But he didn't have to. He didn't have to, but he did. Oh, how much longer is he going to give you?
That's
bringing forth some fruit. We've got to get rid of the dead things in our lives. We've got to get rid of that dead stuff so the good stuff can grow. Amen? Look at your neighbor again. If you don't remember anything, if it don't grow, it's got to go. Say it. What was that in here? Died for me.
Amen.
Musicians, if you'll come. Jesus died. He died for you. Verily, verily, I say unto you, except the corn of wheat fall into the ground, who is that corn of wheat? Mm-mm-mm. Thank God for that corn of wheat. Thank God for Jesus. Except the corn of wheat fall into the ground and die, it abideth alone. But if it die, it bringeth forth much fruit.
Amen.
Thank God for Jesus. He died for us. He brought forth a lot of fruit. He had to die so that you and I could live. Amen. Wake up.
Amen.
Jesus had to die so that we could live.
Amen.
You ought to be rejoicing. You ought to be happy in that. Praise His holy name. Glory to God. And I'm going to live for Him.
Amen.
You have to make that decision. Let's all say, you have to make that decision. Not me, not mom and dad, not anybody else. God's given you a little bit more time today. He's gave you, how long is he going to get you? I don't know, but how long is he going to get you? You know, may not be another breath. If you need Jesus today as Lord and Savior of your life, you need to come. You need to get into the vine. Remember, we're just branches. You need to get into the vine. You need to get saved, as they say. I don't know your heart here today, but God does. If you're here today and you're lost, you need to get saved. You just seem to be wandering through life without any purpose. God's got a purpose for you. He's got His perfect will in your life. Get rid of the
suffering and putting up with us. Amen. Because as I like to quote out of Lamentations 3:23, if it wasn't for the Lord's mercies, it's only by His mercies that we're not consumed.
Amen.
But the Lord's mercies are new.
Yes.
Every morning.
Praise the Lord.
Thank God. When the sun comes up, His mercies do.
Thank
you.
Thank God. He's not asking much out of us, just loving, serving, obeying, following, fearing, trusting Him. And we'll make it all the way.
Amen.
It's been a joy to be here today.
Amen.
Amen. Gonna pick right back up here tonight, probably. You think, well, you done preached all you can, huh?
Oh, no.
Oh, no.